Well, hello everybody and thank you for joining us. My name is Sean Kessel, the North Dakota Interim Commissioner of Commerce. And on behalf of the North Dakota Department of Commerce and in participation with the Greater North Dakota Chamber, we welcome you to our special business briefing on the Hospitality Economic Resiliency Grant. I'll refer to the grant as the HERG throughout this briefing. We intend to provide you with some details and changes related to the grant, answer your questions, and go through a live demonstration of the application process and announce the exact date and time when Commerce will begin accepting online applications for the second round of the HERG. We've learned a great deal over the course of the last few months. We've listened to applicant feedback and input, and we've made some changes that were designed to make the application process easier, allow you more time to respond to questions that we may ask, and to broaden the applicant pool a little bit so more businesses are eligible. Our ultimate goal is to distribute every dollar of federal money to help North Dakota businesses survive. For those of you listening, I'm so glad you could join us. We believe your attendance will provide you a better understanding of how to prepare and successfully apply for the HERG. We encourage you to share this information with anyone who is not able to join us today. A recording of this presentation will be made available on the ndresponse.gov website. And if you have any questions, you can email us at businesshelpcovid19@nd.gov. As I mentioned, we'll provide an overview of the HERG grant, the changes that were made, and try to answer your questions. I will then turn the floor over to Tricia Miller, and she will walk you through a live demo of the application process. And then Chris Kalish from the GNDC will provide some closing remarks. So the HERG is a federally funded business support grant. Federal dollars were provided to each state to use as they saw fit to meet the greatest needs in response to the COVID pandemic. The HERG is intended to support businesses across North Dakota. The hospitality industry continues to be the hardest hit by the pandemic. With the agreement from the Emergency Commission, which is chaired by Governor Burgum, and over 40 North Dakota legislators that make up the budget section, Commerce has been entrusted to distribute dollars to help restaurants, cafes, bars, breweries, theaters, and professional production companies remain viable, open, and serving customers. We'll talk soon about a few other eligible businesses we have included in round two. Hotels with restaurants, bars, coffee shops, and/or banquet or meeting space may apply for the grant if they qualify using the operational expenses eligibility method we will talk about very soon. Limited service hotels without dedicated group space or a restaurant, unfortunately, are not eligible for the HERG, are instead eligible for the HERG Plus. Complimentary breakfasts or breakfasts included in the room rate do not qualify as a restaurant. Eligible expenses must have been incurred on or after March 27th of 2020 and no later than the date of the application. If you've received a HERG grant in round one, you may remain eligible for a grant in round two. If the grant award you received was less than the full amount you were eligible for, you may apply for a round two grant and be eligible for the difference between your round one grant award and the maximum distribution your business qualifies for. So in other words, if you received $15,000 in round one and were eligible for $25,000, you may apply for $10,000 in round two. You do need to submit different expenses in round two than you were reimbursed for in round one. Please remember, there's not an appeals process for the HERG program. Providing all documentation requested and appropriate justification for each expense item will ensure your best chance for success with the grant program. And just one other quick comment regarding the original Economic Resiliency Grant, or ERG. That program is no longer accepting applications, and we do not anticipate additional rounds. As I mentioned earlier, we have listened to applicants and changed a few things with round two. With the federal deadline being extended, we can now allow more time for you to reply to questions that we may have. You will have 3 business days instead of 1 to reply to our initial email contact. If we do not receive a response in that 3-day window, then another email will be sent and you'll be given an additional 3 days to respond. If we receive no response after the 2nd email, the expenditure and/or the application will be denied. Please make sure you look for our emails in all of your email folders to make sure that those emails regarding your grant application weren't routed into a junk folder or other folder by your computer. It has happened in the past. Applicants will self-certify that they have not been awarded for expenditures previously submitted in HERG Round 1. So in other words, please don't submit expenses you have already been reimbursed for. You need to submit different expenses in Round 2 than you did in Round 1. And by different, I mean not exactly the same. If you were reimbursed for payroll in Round 1, you can still submit for payroll reimbursement in Round 2. It just can't be the same payroll you were reimbursed for in Round 1. And one more comment related to internal operations. You know, our reviewers have more experience now and they've had additional training. So we anticipate better efficiency and outcomes with Round 2. A reminder of who is eligible. A grantee can be a restaurant that includes food trucks, to include food services and drinking establishments that derive a minimum of 51% of their sales from prepared foods and must certify that 75% of sales were derived in North Dakota, as well as having a current food established license issued by the appropriate legal entity. A bar or lounge with a current on-sale liquor license issued by an appropriate legal entity that derives a minimum of 51% of sales from online sales is also eligible. And an entertainment value or venue to include movie, drama, or music theaters and facilities used to host community and private events, and that derive a minimum of 51% of the revenue from either a rental or admissions. All those eligibility requirements are the same as in Round 1, but here is a change. We've expanded the eligible pool to include some indoor recreation and/or entertainment venues. So now bowling alleys, indoor golf clubs, and indoor trampoline parks are eligible businesses. And finally, a production company that provides technology and audiovisual services to meetings and events and certifies that 75% of their sales were derived in North Dakota are also eligible. Applicants must self-certify that they meet the requirements and will comply with current North Dakota Smart Restart protocols. Non-compliance with these protocols will result in the repayment of all grant funds. We'll go over self-certifications in more detail later in this briefing. So sometimes clarity is achieved by sharing who is not eligible. Government-owned facilities that do not generate more than 51% of their revenue from private events, in-home caterers, food and/or liquor establishments without appropriate licensure, retail food, groceries, or gas stations who do not derive a minimum of 51% of their sales from prepared food, religious organizations unless they meet the restaurant criteria, and lodging facilities that do not have qualifying event space or restaurants. On the next slide, we'll talk about self-certifications. An applicant must make in an application process. These may seem trivial, but they're actually very important because if your business cannot self-certify these items, then your business is not eligible. Other reasons these self-certifications are very important is that they are reviewed during audits. And in the unfortunate event that a business self-certified the validity of all the questions to become eligible and the audit identifies an error, then all the grant funds must be returned. We don't want to subject any business to this process, so please review these self-certifications closely and make sure you are confident and can support your responses. I touched on grant amounts a little bit in my opening remarks. And the limits are unchanged from round one. If you have 1 eligible location, you would qualify for up to $25,000. If you have 2 eligible locations, then you qualify for up to $50,000 at $25,000 per location. And if you have more than two eligible locations, then you can apply for $75,000 and a maximum of $25,000 per location. Where this gets tricky is when you've received a grant from round one. If you received a full award of $25,000 and have one location, you are not eligible for round two. If you have a single location and received a partial award in round one, let's say $15,000, you can apply for the difference between the maximum award of $25,000 and the award you received in round one. In this example, you'd be eligible to apply for $10,000 in round two. I would like to walk you through another example. So if you receive funds for more than one location in round one, the same rules still apply. If you are eligible for more than one location, you can apply for the difference you receive from round one and the maximum eligible award. So for instance, if you have two locations and in round one you receive $15,000 for location A and $10,000 for location B, you are eligible to apply for $10,000 for location A and $15,000 for location B. You can extrapolate the same formula if you have more than two locations. If you have questions after the briefing, you can revisit this presentation once it's posted on our website or email us, and we'll provide you with those locations a little bit later in the presentation. We've been asked many times about the documentation requirements related to the grant, and I just have a brief comment related to that. The audit environment in which Commerce and other state agencies must work within today requires us to make completely sure that any activity we pursue is thoroughly reviewed, documentation is clear and concise, and we feel the need to double and sometimes triple check all of our work. A comprehensive review of the required documentation is available on our website. I'm not going to go through all the details today and instead highly encourage you to visit our website at belegendary.link/HERG. The link will be provided later in this briefing as well. Another comment regarding documentation is applicants are responsible for providing sufficient documentation for all costs, justification for why these items are eligible, and proof of payment. Legitimate receipts must include itemization, an item description or a picture, the total purchase price, the date, verification of payment in full, and evidence it came from the vendor. An example would be the use of letterhead. When uploading receipts, it is limited to one expenditure per line item, and we'll review this closer during the live demo a little bit later. If any of the required information above is missing, or if a receipt is in any way editable, the applicant must provide additional transaction information such as canceled checks, credit card statements, bank drafts, emails, etc., which provide the missing information. Please be sure to align what line item is associated with what expense on a receipt or an invoice. A paid stamp is only allowed if there is a zero balance on the invoice. Invoices marked paid without a zero balance must be accompanied by corresponding documentation of payment, such as the front and back of a canceled check or bank statements or credit card statements. Sales taxes are not an allowable expense and cannot be included for reimbursement. Next, we'll try to go through some of your specific questions that were submitted. If you have questions that did not get answers, please email us at businesshelpcovid19@nd.gov and we'll provide a specific answer to you. So utility bills. Can we upload all the utility bills on the same line? The answer is no. Each utility bill, along with accompanying proof of payment, needs to be on a separate line item. Will the utility bill from a previous month qualify to show we have paid the expense? The answer is no. You need to upload and accompany both sides of a canceled check, bank statement, or a redacted credit card highlighted to show the amount that has been paid. Are internet service charges or cable satellite TV eligible? The answer is yes. So for payroll, can funding go towards wages of lost hours due to early shutdown? And the answer is no, only paid hours qualify. Will a copy of the employee's check printed from QuickBooks work as a receipt? And the answer is yes, as long as their names appears on the document. Under food service and beverage, the first question is, can I receive grant money for all bar staff salaries from March 17th through the grant submission? And the answer is, operational costs, including payroll, for bar staff must occur on or after March 27th of 2020. The next question was, can businesses that aren't specifically hospitality, but used as a gathering place in small towns, such as morning coffee at the elevator, gas stations, or car dealerships, qualify? The answer is, the intent of the grant is to support hospitality businesses who have lost revenue due to COVID-19. Therefore, other gathering places would not be eligible. The next question is, if all prepared food and drink establishments are qualified to apply, what about breweries and wineries? And the answer is yes, breweries and wineries that have a minimum of 51% of revenue come from prepared food or drink served on premises are eligible. The next questions are related to documentation. Is there any possibility for an extension if additional measures are advised? 3 business days from email notification will be provided to provide documentation. The next question is, if a utility is paid by autodraft and reflected as paid in a subsequent month's bill, may we upload both as proof, or will you require a bank statement, credit card bill, or etc.? And it continues by saying, is a cleared check sufficient for rent, or is a rent invoice required as well? The response is, corresponding documentation, such as a cleared check or invoice, is sufficient with the bank statement. The next question regarding ownership. This is a complicated answer, and I would again request that you visit our website for additional clarity. The next line is venues. Our next questions, excuse me, are venues. And the question is, we are a dance studio that offers performing arts performances throughout the year, but due to COVID, we've not been able to hold any of our productions. Would we be able to qualify for this grant, or what would we need to have to qualify for the grant? The response is, in general, dance studios would not be eligible since most of the revenue is generated from class fees. The exception to this would be if the studio has a venue to host events and charges admission and the revenue is 51% or greater. Can you specify the required income sources and percentages for indoor entertainment? An entertainment venue, including indoor recreation entertainment, such as bowling alleys, indoor golf clubs, and indoor trampoline parks, who charge a public admission fee. If membership fees exceed 51% of revenue, they are eligible. Would a fitness center, gym, or YMCA qualify? In general, fitness centers and gyms are not eligible as their revenue comes from membership or class fees. And one additional venues related question, can funds be used for improvements that create more space in a movie theater? Is the cost to replace seats an eligible expense? And can the operator of 2 theaters apply for funds for both locations? What are the most common reasons why an application for 2 locations would be denied? The answer is repairs are allowed, but expansion costs are not. Equipment used for daily operation but not for expansions are allowed. If 2 theaters apply and ownership is 50% or greater, regardless of whether the business has a separate EIN, they are only eligible for 1 application. An applicant must list each business under this guideline and will be awarded accordingly to the 25, 50, and 75,000 maximum rule. Most common reasons that applications are denied for multiple locations are, if there are multiple applications where the ownership is 50% or greater, There should only be one application and each location is capped at 25,000. The campus policy defining a campus as the following: a campus is defined as a business under the same ownership structure within a quarter mile of one another's physical location and therefore only eligible for $25,000. So the application window for the second round of HERD will open on Thursday, February 4th at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time. The application window is expected to stay open for 3 weeks and closing on Thursday, February 25th at 5 p.m. Central Standard Time. Please do not wait until the very end of the closing time. We've had people begin their application with just a few minutes left until close, and if there are any issues at all, computer issues, connection issues, etc., those applications are not able to be submitted. So please allow sufficient time to complete the application before the deadline. We have approximately $30 million to distribute in round two. If we do not receive sufficient applications with eligible expenses, we intend to conduct a second round of the HERD Plus, designed for hotels, motels, and resorts. If grant funds remain to offer round two of the HERD Plus, we will announce that in another business briefing towards the end of February or early March. Now I'd like to invite Tricia Miller to walk us through a live demonstration of the grant application. Once she is done, we'll have a few additional closing remarks. Tricia?
Thank you, Sean. Hopefully everybody's seeing my screen. Sean, are we seeing the screen? You can hear
me? Yes, we are.
Okay,
we
perfect. Are. Okay. Thanks to everybody for coming on to our call today. And I know the last time we went through this online demo, we felt like it was very beneficial for businesses and we heard some positive feedback. And so we wanted to run through the application process and about a couple areas that have been modified on the application. What you're seeing on the screen, and I'm gonna also encourage, please don't grab this URL up here. This is a development site. And so don't try going out here and registering early thinking you can get this done before and get into the process, because this is not a live site. So I wanted to make that note. When you come out here to the website, and we'll have the link will be available on that belegendary.link/HERG. There'll be a button on that page where you'll be able to get to the login page to come to the portal to do your application. On the home page of here, it'll give an overview of the entire program for the HERG round two program. If you are a previous user or an applicant that has logged into this portal before, you can use your same login information. If you are a new applicant, you will see a sign up button. So what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to come up to the sign in button up at the top. It's going to bring you into this. I'm going to keep coming into the email and log into my account because I have an existing account here. If you are a first time user and you've never done this, you're going to want to click on the register here and you're going to want to click on it to register your application or your account to be able to add an application. I will also make note that when you do register for the first time, it's going to ask for an email confirmation. You can continue on with your application and applying and getting it submitted, but you will be getting an email back on an email verification for you just to verify that this is truly an email that's tied to your account. The reason that's super important is any correspondence that we do with you needs to have that email confirmation. So please check your junk folder, any folders in your email account that would maybe have that reply come back from our Commerce office for your email verification. So at this point, I'm going to go ahead and just sign in. Then on this page is going to be your landing page. It's going to give a little bit of an overview again of the program. There is a link out here where it links back to the site where you can verify all the items that Sean discussed earlier here in the presentation. At this point, if you were a previous applicant, you're going to see all the previous applications that you were awarded below. You won't be able to get into those to do anything, but you can still view those applications if you would like to. That would also help you as far as expenses that you maybe have expensed in HERG round one, so that you know what you previously had submitted for expenditures. So at this point, we're going to go ahead and just click on Create Application. And on this page, nothing really has changed from the first round. The one thing that I do want to reiterate again is about the business name. This is very important that your name that you list here for your business is exactly to what any tax record or how you report to the on your taxes. You can do a doing business as, and we highly encourage that if you're a sole proprietor, to please list your trade name in the doing business as field. And then again, you're going to enter in your tax identification number. And then what happens is we run, once your application has been approved, we run this through our federal TIN system, and we match it up against the business name and your tax identification number to make sure that it is legit. Okay, the next screen that you're seeing here is where you're going to want to put in all of your information on your business. Okay, and the first it's going to ask about who you are and what your role is on submitting this application. So you're going to come in here and you're going to type in maybe you're the owner of this business. And again, to reiterate what Sean said earlier, you can have one application for all of your ownership that's greater than the 50%. So we'll talk about that here down below where it asks you to list all owner percentages for this business. You're going to come in and you're going to want to do your phone number. Okay. And then it's going to ask you about how many employees were at your physical location as of January 1st of 20. And then it's going to ask you how many employees you have at your location today. Here again is that box where we're going to ask about your ownership. I'll just type that in here quickly. All right. Then down here, the important thing about doing the physical address is you have to have a physical address where it says physical address. No PO boxes are going to be allowed in here. And this is due to us being able to research your facility and do, you know, and just knowing exactly that physical address of your business. In the city lookup button, if you click that, one of the things that got a little tricky with some people in the past is they wanted to come up here and just start typing a city to find it. If you see here, there's a little black box that pops up here when I just hover my mouse over it. There's a wildcard feature that you do have to check in here and type before you start typing. So if I want to come in here and I just want to type in Bowman, I have to hit an asterisk first, and you can actually hit enter and it will find your city for you. And then you can go ahead and just hit select. Okay. If by chance the mailing address, which is where your check will get mailed once you are awarded, if your mailing address equals your physical address, you can literally just click the same as physical address button. If you wanted to go to a PO box, this is your opportunity to enter that information in here as the mailing address. And again, it cannot have physical or PO boxes in the physical address. I'm going to say that we are going to keep it as same as my physical address. Okay, then I'm going to move on. The next set of questions is just more about your application, and it mentions a little bit about what Sean had gone through previously on some slides. Your business must be located in North Dakota. You have to verify these. Is your business in your home? No, my business is not in my home. What is your registering entity for this business? I'm registered with the Secretary of State. If you are a tribal business, do you participate in the 477? I am not a tribal business. This is not a required field, so therefore I can skip this question. Is this business registered to do business in North Dakota? Meaning, are you in good standing? I'm going to say yes. Is this business allowed to legally conduct business in North Dakota? Yes. Over to the right here, it's going to ask you questions of what type of business you are. Over the next field is selecting your NAICS code. And we know by the type of businesses that are allowed in the HERG program, you know, we'll come down here, we'll come into that category of 72. I'm gonna just pick accommodation and food services for the sake. Industry title NAICS level 2 code, that one is no longer required field. If you would like to add that in, you most certainly can. I'm gonna go past that. What portion of the funding is from a public funding source? I'm gonna say I do not get any funding from a local, state, tribal, or federal sources. Okay, that does exclude grants. And then I'm going to describe the my description of my business. Type whatever your type of business is in there, and you can go ahead and type any type of text you would like in there. Now this is the next part where Sean outlined about the facilities and who what you're allowed for your maximum amounts. So if I am an owner and I have my ownership is greater than 50% in multiple businesses, this is where I have to list those applications. So if I have another location where I own greater than 50%, I need to come in here and enter that business name in here. And I am going to be this one this time. And I'm going to say that I'm 100% owner on this one. Okay, so then the address again would be pick your address. Enter in your physical address again here. You're going to come in. This is going to be the same type of information. You're going to select your city. Okay, then it's also going to ask you the number of employees that you have. And you're going to complete this. Now you're going to notice that I have listed two facilities here. I'm going to continue on. Now what you're going to notice is this next screen, when you have to go add in your expenditures, it's going to outline for you what your maximum award is. You're going to see that I'm awarded at $50,000. And the reason I'm awarded $50,000 is because I have two locations. Now keep in mind, this also you need to take into account if you did previously submit expenditures for these two locations in round one. So that would go off of what Sean had mentioned in his examples earlier, that each of these locations, so say in the first round, I was awarded only $40,000 and I'm eligible for $50,000 and I would have applied for both locations in round one. I'm still eligible for $10,000. However, you still have to keep the amount at $25,000 per location. So you need to be cognitive when you're entering this information in. Okay. So we also still have a spreadsheet to kind of itemize some of your payroll cost summary. And you can just click on this and it will provide you an Excel sheet for you to go ahead and itemize your expenses and will assist you on adding these expenditures. So you can go ahead and just click add expenditure. One of the new questions that are asked on here is at the very top. We're asking you to certify that you have not submitted this line expenditure in the past HERG application or have been awarded this. Maybe you were not awarded it. We'll change the wording here, I guess, a little bit. We'll have to say awarded for this line expenditure in HERG round one. So you cannot have been paid for this same line expenditure in this next round. So I'm going to certify that that is true. I am going to say that it's payroll. And as this one, I am going to go ahead and just say that I am going to say that this is my restaurant. And, you know, maybe it was, I can't even remember the names of my groups that I put out here, but it would be my restaurant and I'm going to be the vendor for this. So you don't have to actually submit another vendor on here, but if it's yourself that's paying that payroll, you can just say my restaurant. Expenditure type. I'm going to come in here and I'm going to select payroll and you're going to see all of the options on here of the things that you can submit. One of the other things that is very important on here too, when you're doing your name or your description of your business, it's very important that you're noting on here payroll for business, whatever your first business name was for business. This is my restaurant, so I can't even remember the names of my companies right now, but you would list the name of your company on this line. So that the reviewers can understand which this expenditure goes with which location. Okay. Purchase date is no longer required, but if you wanted to, so maybe this was for December's payroll. You could just come in and pick, you know, December 31st. So maybe my payroll was 20,000. This would be the second field here, qualifying portion of purchase amount. This would be what you want to get paid for. This top one is if it's what the total receipt amount is. This is not going to be what the system is going to configure. There was some confusion with this in some of the other rounds. This total receipt amount means the total full receipt amount that you're submitting. The second one, qualifying portion, is what you want to get paid for. Okay, I only want to get paid $10,000 of that $20,000 receipt that I'm going to attach. This one was where you would put if there was taxes or anything that you wanted to make sure that we knew was not included in this total. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and hit continue. Okay, at this point, it's asking me to upload an attachment, which Sean has outlined earlier, and there'll be some more documentation on the website. There is already for you to go out there and view what's an acceptable type of document. And also to know what file types are supported here are JPEGs, PDFs, .docs, which are Word documents, .xlss's. Those sort of documents are the types that are approved to be uploaded into the system. And you can see that up here. And then to also make sure that your file sizes is not greater than 20 megabyte, or they will get kicked out. And we've had some people that did have some complications with that. So what you're going to do at this point, you're going to come out here and it's going to ask you to go ahead and just upload a document. And then you can see where you can grab it from your computer, wherever you have it saved. And then you go ahead and you just hit complete. And it's going to bring you back to that same expenditure page again. And here's where you would continue to enter each and every line expenditure for your application. And I'm going to go ahead and do next. All right, this part of the application is where you need to self-certify on several questions throughout the grant process. The first one is that we're asking, was your business viable on 3/1 of 2020? Or my business was a startup in an operation prior to that and is projected to be viable within the 180 days of 3/1. I'm going to agree. My business was not more than 90 days delinquent on any loans prior to March 1st of 2020. Your business must be in good standing with the state of North Dakota or equivalent tribal entity. And the business is not currently delinquent on any federal or state taxes. The next set of questions is about how your business was impacted by the COVID-19 pandemic. The first question is that you have incurred a negative financial impact due to COVID-19. Did your business close a result? No, I may not have closed. My business voluntarily closed? No. My business was forced to lay off or furlough employees? That may be the case. And my business closed due to executive orders? That might be the case. The next set of applications is more certifications again. The first one is important, so that it's read to understand that the requirements regarding the improvements eligible for the HERG 2 round and that the application that you're submitting complies with all of those requirements that we've outlined in the process to help reduce that spread of infection. I certify that I have the authority to submit this and request on behalf of the named entity. So this is talking to me as the applicant, as the contact person, that I have the authority to submit this request. And that you have not submitted a hospitality grant round two, HERG two, in the past 30 days. That means you're only eligible for one application on the HERG two. The next set is basically kind of what Sean outlined earlier, how when we, that's why we ask the questions that we do when we ask for receipt documentation and such, so that you're certifying that you will provide to us all this information and understand that this application could go underneath an audit. The next one is where you're gonna verify what type of business you are. And you have to be one of these four. You can be multiple, but you have to be one of these four. So I'm gonna come in here and I'm gonna say that I am a restaurant. Then we're asking you to verify that nothing that you're requesting was approved in HERG round one. Okay, we're getting close to the end. This part, you're going to certify that you, everything that you're submitted is correct to the best of your knowledge. You're also agreeing that you're going to abide by the ND Smart Restart guidelines. And there is a link to our protocols right here on this page too, if you an easy navigation tool for you. And then also we're saying that you will agree to provide all additional information requested from our from the reviewers. At this point, this is an overview of your application that you previously submitted. A lot of people would like to print this application. If you do, you literally just right mouse click right on your screen here and you do print and you will get a copy of this. If at any point after you've reviewed this application, if something is inaccurate and you want to redo it, you come to the bottom of the screen and you go back to previous and you can go ahead and go back and modify some of the things that you've done. Once you hit submit, this is a done deal. You cannot go back in and edit your application. Okay, so we're gonna hit submit here. It's gonna get one more final confirmation. If you're still not confident that it's accurate, you can hit cancel here and go back. At this point, I'm gonna hit submit. And you're gonna get a thank you. And then when you come back and you select the home button up at the top, you'll see your application sitting in there. And again, you'll just be able to view it. You won't be able to edit it. At the point where you can edit it will be when it's under review and if additional info is needed, then your portal will be opened up for you to add additional information and documents into those line items. All right, Sean, I think I'm gonna share it back to you.
Thank you, Tricia. Appreciate you walking us through the application process and that live demo. We'll just give it a second here before we get the PowerPoint back up for all of you. What we want to do now is just provide you with a great deal of contact information for us. And I want to make one comment about that review button. Please make sure that you do review your grant. What we have, we certainly have had applicants, what I'm going to call fat finger their numbers or transpose their numbers. They intended to apply for $2,500 for a certain line item, and instead they put in $250. Once you hit submit, as Tricia mentioned, it's you can't go back. So please review your application. Make sure that all your data is accurate. So the contact email for us is businesshelpcovid19, all one word as you see it on the screen there, at nd.gov. There's a lot of other ways that we that you can connect with Commerce, and we hope that today has been helpful, and we'll communicate updates through our website, ndresponse.gov, and our social media channels. It's important that you follow us at CommerceND on Facebook and Twitter. You can also follow us on LinkedIn at the Department of Commerce and on Instagram at Commerce North Dakota, all spelled out. You can sign up for our newsletters on our website, commerce.nd.gov/news/signup-news-releases. Our website is belegendary.link/HERG. If questions remain, you have at least three ways to get those answers. You can visit our website, belegendary.link/HERG. You can review the frequently asked questions or FAQs, which can be found at ndresponse.gov. And if you didn't find your answer on either of those resources, you can email us at businesshelpcovid19@nd.gov. Please be sensitive to the possibility that we may be receiving hundreds of inquiries. We will get back to you, but it may take a little bit of time. Thank you for attending today. Thank you for being North Dakota Smart. Thank you for the privilege of supporting you during this trying time. And to wrap up our briefing today, I'd like to turn it over to Chris Kalish, the Director of Membership with Greater North Dakota Chamber, for some closing remarks. Chris, are you there? Chris may be having some technical difficulties. So if I would just be able to say on his behalf, the recording and materials of today's session will be available on Commerce's website, but they'll also be linked to ndchamber.com. That's ndchamber.com. And on behalf of GNDC and the Department of Commerce, we really thank you for attending today. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day.